This paper is one of many, many, many papers that studies the following big picture question. Do expected returns vary across assets because the assets have different exposures to macroeconomic risks? Like much of this literature, this paper focuses on stocks. So don't do that, do that. Okay, so a standard tool in this literature is the two-pass regression, or the Fama-McBeth version of the two-pass regression. The literature started back with Tenroll and Ross in 86, where they're looking at exposures to industrial production, expected inflation, unexpected inflation, term structure shocks, and a few others. They were a little diffuse in their views. So the results of this literature were largely disappointing until some papers came along, starting with Park and Julliard, that argued if we measure aggregate consumption better, or measure aggregate consumption risk better than we've been doing, it turns out that cross-sectional exposure to aggregate consumption risk is quite helpful in explaining the cross-section of mean returns to stocks. So here's a standard example. It uses annual consumption growth measured as in Jagannathan and Wang. So the basic idea is you start with some Fama French portfolios, or portfolios constructed like Fama and French construct their portfolios. The ones here are deciles sorted on size, and then some others sorted on book to market, and some others sorted on asset growth. So you estimate the consumption betas, you plot them along with the sample returns, and then you run your second pass regression through the dots. And the results are really impressive. Like that blue line says, wow, maybe expected returns to these portfolios are driven by exposure to aggregate consumption risk. It certainly puts aggregate consumption risk back on the table as a possible explanation of cross-sectional variation in expected returns to assets, right? But what this figure shows is a spread in estimated betas. Recent research, and here I'm going to highlight a paper that came out in the JF this year by Kleibergen and Zhang. This dispersion in estimated betas doesn't necessarily tell you much about a dispersion in true betas. And in fact, Kleibergen and Zhang argue you can't actually tell that there's any variation in true betas of these portfolios given these estimated betas. And if you can't reject the hypothesis that actually all of the true betas are the same, there's no point in drawing that blue line. It's a meaningless regression, right? Now, this is very much work in progress, thinking in progress. For example, on Tim's website, you can find a recent paper where he basically says to Kleibergen and Zhang, eh, not so much. Now, from my perspective, this debate is very much in the weeds of econometric methods. When should we use multivariate tests versus univariate tests? Is an F test robust in this setting? What does it mean to be econometrically robust? And you know, it's all just intellectually fascinating, but I think the profession would be better off if we could just bypass this entire debate. And how do we do that? We go and get better betas. And that's really where this paper is going to start. So how do we get better betas? And what does it mean to have better betas? You want betas that are estimated more precisely, and you want betas that have a wider dispersion. So how do you get more precision? You got to use more finely sampled data. So you need to have macroeconomic shocks that you measure at a higher frequency than annually or quarterly, right? That's one thing you need to do. But you also want to have a bigger spread in the macro betas. And the way you do that is you don't use Fama French portfolios, you sort on macro betas, right? So don't use size, don't use book to market, but you want to sort by macro betas. Now, there's a subtlety here, which is you don't really want to sort on past betas. What you really want to sort on are expected future betas. Now, this, I don't know who came up with this idea. The first time I saw it was in Pastor and Stambaugh in their liquidity paper. It probably predates them because the whole idea of building factor models for conditional betas goes back to the late 1980s with John Campbell and Wayne Ferson and Jay Schenken. So in practice, when we work with factors that are excess returns, there's just no point in bothering with this. And that's because when you estimate betas using factors that are excess returns, they're just estimated so precisely, you don't have to worry about getting the precision better. The dispersion in betas is sufficiently large. You don't have to worry about getting additional dispersion. It's only when you're talking about macro risks, like liquidity risk, right, for Pastor and Stambaugh, or the macro risk that this paper is talking about, that you really want to be a little more sophisticated than say, hey, let's just sort on past betas and use those to form portfolios. So the paper today is going to get better betas. It's going to use higher frequency data, and it doesn't simply sort on past betas. It attempts to get at expected future betas, not in the full-blown way of, say, Pastor and Stambaugh in a factor model way, but it's simply going to do a better job. So you got yourself better betas. What are you going to do with them? Let's talk about Gibbons, Ross, and Schenken. And when I say let's us talk about it, really, it's just me talking here. So Gibbons, Ross, and Schenken technology automatically produces something that I'll call the best hedged portfolio. Consider all portfolios that have zero factor risk. One of them maximizes the Sharpe ratio. That's the one that Gibbons, Ross, and Schenken technology focuses on, right? Now, when we do two pass regressions with, say, macro factors, we don't really focus on that portfolio. There's no technological reason why you can't, but in general, we don't. What this paper does is it constructs something I'm gonna call a good enough hedged portfolio. It's a construction that you can explain to anyone, and it doesn't rely on the somewhat obscure linear algebra of quadratic forms. So what they're gonna do with this, with these good enough hedge portfolios is ask the question, what do you lose if you invest in a well-diversified portfolio that has stripped macro risk out of it? So that's a very interesting question. And to hear more about it, I'm gonna turn it over to Bernard. And to do that, I gotta stop sharing my slides.
All right, Bernard, you can share slides and then you have about 15 minutes.
Okay, 1 second. Okay, so hopefully everyone can see my slide.
Yes.
Okay, great. So thank you, thank you very much for the invitation to present at the Virtual Finance Workshop today. Really appreciate it. And thanks, Greg, for the very generous introduction and for everyone attending the seminar. Looking forward to the discussion and feedback. So I'm gonna take a step back and motivate. I know Greg did like a wonderful job, but I want to motivate the paper showing a few interesting pictures. We know that the stock market, this is joint work with Alan Moreira from Rochester and Tyler Muir. They're both here attending the seminar as well and answering questions on the chat. So please ask as many questions as you want. Would be great to have your feedback and comments. The stock market experienced a significant market crash this year because of the COVID-19 pandemic. We know that starting in February 19, in a 6-week span, US stocks dropped more than 30%. And at the same time, volatility spiked above 80%. A very similar pattern also happened in the previous recession 12 years earlier. The Great Recession of 2008 had a similar pattern. In 2008, stock markets dropped by more than 50% and volatility again spiked above 80%. And in fact, this is a common pattern to economic recessions. Market usually drops 20% on average in economic recessions identified by the NBR recession months. So there is a strong relation between market crashes and recessions. And recessions are particular moments in time from an economic perspective, because there's a lot of uncertainty. For example, credit may become more restrictive. There is uncertainty if firms can rely on suppliers. There is uncertainty if they on the demand side as well. All these facts make recessions risky investment periods. So what we do in this paper is to investigate whether we can hedge recession risk. And if we are able to hedge recession risk, what is the cost in terms of what is the reduction in expected returns that one would face if you build a tradable, well-diversified portfolio that hedges against recession risk. To do that, what we're going to have is to focus on macroeconomic factors. These are going to be indicators of broad macroeconomic conditions, things like consumption, GDP, unemployment, credit spreads, and so on. The macrofinance literature, as Greg pointed out earlier, had translated a lot of those in a slightly different ways into asset pricing factors. And these include, for example, the Parker-Julliard consumption factor, the Q4 to Q4 consumption growth, or the unfiltered consumption growth. Also, one could look at, for example, reduced form asset pricing factors. This is not something because of the limitation of time, this is not something I will talk about today, but the slides are available online and you can see the result at the end. And we have similar results and similar analysis and similar results for traded factors as well. So let me preview a little bit of our approach and our main findings before I get into all the details of what exactly what we do in our results. Our approach, we try to do something extremely simple, and I think this is a feature of our paper, which is that we're going to build portfolios based on exposures. So we're going to have beta relative to macroeconomic indicators. So I'm talking about industrial production beta, that is like a beta relative to industrial production growth, or initial claims and unemployment related betas, or betas relative to credit spreads and so on. We're going to construct beta sorted portfolios. And these beta sorted portfolios, they're going to provide a good and natural methodology to build what we're calling here macro sensitive portfolios. So these are going to be portfolios that on the highest portfolio bucket, you're going to have portfolios that are going to be more sensitive, of course, provided that the sorting works. You're going to have portfolios that are more sensitive to macroeconomic conditions. And in the lowest bin, you're going to have portfolios that are less sensitive to macroeconomic conditions. So this is going to provide a very intuitive way to build hedge portfolios, which is going to be the lowest bin, which are the portfolios that are less sensitive to macroeconomic conditions, and short the bin, the stocks, the portfolio that are more sensitive to macroeconomic conditions, which are located in the highest portfolio bin. What we find, and I think our results are very surprising and interesting for various reasons, is that the first thing is that we're able to actually build good, and I'll be specific what I mean by that, hedge portfolios against various like recession-related risk factors. What I mean by good is that exposed, the post-formation exposure of these portfolios is exactly what we wanted, in the sense that they perform well in bad times. So they're gonna have negative exposure to consumption, to GDP, to recessions, et cetera. And what is also interesting, and if you compare the version that is available online and the result that I'm presenting here today, there is a little bit of a difference because we extended the sample. The version online ends in 2018, and we basically didn't change our methodology at all and extended the sample to include the COVID-19 pandemic recession. This is a genuine out-of-sample test because we haven't changed the methodology, and you can compare with the paper that is available online. And more than that, the COVID-19 pandemic is exactly the type of recession risk that we are trying to hedge against. Why? Because it was like an event, it is an event that had faced like a serious market, had like one large market crash of about 30%. At the same time, GDP dropped in the first quarter by 5% in annual terms. And in the second quarter, it declined by a record high of negative more than 30% drop at annual values in the second quarter of 2020. Also, not only on the production side, but also on the employment side is a very large recession. For example, initial claims historically has always been like below a million claims weekly. And when the recession hit it, it actually almost hit it like a 7 million initial claims for unemployment. That value is still above a million this week. So, the fact that our results hold in this very specific out of sample, which is the COVID-19 pandemic, which to some extent is like exactly the type of scenario our portfolios are intended to hedge, I think it shows the robustness of our findings. The surprising result, however, is that the macro sensitive portfolios, they have similar average returns regardless of that exposure, which means is that the portfolios that are more sensitive to macro conditions and the less sensitive to macro conditions have similar average returns. So that means that the to build these hedge portfolios, the cost in terms of lowering expected returns is low. So that's why we're saying here the hedge portfolios are cheap, where the cost is this how much you have to forego average returns when building these long short portfolios. So this is our like key finding. And one important thing to understand is why are these findings surprising? On one hand, it is well understood in the literature that there is a weak, sort of a weak relation between macroeconomy and returns in a lot of ways, depending on how you measure. However, the relation between market crashes on the eve of economic recessions is very strong. In the data, we know that in recessions, market usually drops by 20% per recession. This one was like 30, the previous one was a little more, but it's on average is about 20% using the full sample of historical recessions. On the other, you have another traditional argument, which is like a no free lunch argument, that if you have an asset that pays well in bad states of the world, then that asset has to have a negative premium. And that's not exactly what we find. An important contribution to our paper is that it speaks to a large literature on consumption-based asset pricing models. And we know that historically, a lot of the consumption-based asset pricing models have been rejected, but there are like a new wave of recent models that provide a much more helpful understanding for this macro view of asset pricing. And this goes, for example, papers that focus on how to measure consumption or long-run risk-based model. This is a long literature, so I apologize if not mentioning your paper if you're watching this, but I just want to give a highlight, a high-level highlight of the state of this literature. And I want to focus specifically on something that is called scale-based consumption models. And this is a term in the macro chapter by Sydney Ludvigsen. So these are models that, and that's a quote from her chapter, that a key feature of these models is that assets are risky precisely because they become more correlated with consumption in bad times. So this is an idea of how to reconcile with a weak relation between macro and macro economy and returns. We make most of the time, it kind of doesn't matter. And then in bad times, they make them correlated with consumption. And that's like a key feature of a lot of different models. And there's like a very extremely well-written description and explanation of this channel in Sydney's chapter. So I highly recommend everyone to read. In terms of our paper, what we do here is to provide, to focus on the cross-section of assets to hedge macroeconomic risk. And our finding is that market crashes associated with macro risks are hedgeable, especially in bad times when we're talking about economic recessions. And more importantly, our portfolios are going to be tradable. They're going to be well-diversified portfolios. And you see, once we go to the details of the methodology, I will highlight why they're like, we view them as extremely tradable. And one way to view our results as a tool for future consumption-based model, in that you have the ability to hedge at least part of that macro risk. So that's something that we should think about it when thinking about like consumption-based models more generally. Okay, so let me get into the details of what exactly we do. In terms of the data, we use very standard data sets. These are all available online and relatively easy to get. So these are going to be industrial production growth, initial claims. So this is going to be just like a higher frequency version of unemployment. We're going to flip the sign of initial claim, and we also have credit spreads. We're flipping the sign because we want variables just to go up in good times and down in bad times. That's the only reason, to standardize the signal, the direction of those variables. So we know that unemployment is high in recession, so we flip the sign. Credit spreads widen in recession, so we flip the sign. We're also going to have a slope of the term structure, which is viewed as a variable that tends to predict recessions as well. And we're going to have a combination of these four series, which is going to be an equally weighted average of standardized macro monthly series. So this is just a way to combine, a very simple, straightforward way to combine these series. We're also going to have data on NVR recessions, GDP, consumption growth, and so on. Okay, so once we have the data, let me explain what we do in details. Our methodology is going to be extremely simple. And I think this is a great feature in terms of applicability, tradability, and also transparency of our results. For each factor, we're going to construct beta sorted portfolios. We're going to estimate the beta. If you want the sensitivity of the portfolio return, of the stock return to a specific macro indicator. So these are going to be, for example, industrial production beta. We're going to sort these from low to high, define breakpoints by the New York Stock Exchange stocks, which are larger stocks. So that forces each bin to be tradable. And we're using quantiles, which means that there's a lot of stocks in each bin. So it's a very well-diversified and tradable portfolios, both the highest and the lowest quantile. Then we're going to long the low beta quantile and short the highest beta one. In terms of what to expect, if we think about that...
Could you say a little bit about how you're... That description didn't make clear that you're not actually sorting on past betas. You're doing something more sophisticated than that, or at least different.
Can you repeat that? I couldn't hear.
Describe more precisely how you form these portfolios. What are you sorting on? How do you distinguish between the correlation and the standard deviation?
So we are sorting on these betas. Now you're talking about what is in the middle here of the formula, right? Is that the question?
Right. So what's that doing there? What are you doing with that?
What's going on here is that you can think as the, when you have a univariate regression, you can write the beta as the product of the correlation between the two series and the volatility ratio of the two series. Now, empirically, we know from, for example, the betting against beta paper, these things may move at different frequencies. One may be like more slow moving. So typically, correlations are viewed as something that's going to move a little slower, and volatility is something that's going to move at a slightly higher frequency. So then we estimate the volatility ratio and the correlation separately when building these betas. You could do everything using the same window, and then would be like a standard regression beta. That's the only reason. It's not, our results don't change much if you use like the same window for both of them. This is like a feedback that we got earlier on that this is maybe like a better way to have these betas. Once we have these betas, we construct beta sorted portfolios. So what we expect, if the hedge portfolio works in the sense that these are pre-formation betas, but if the post-formation betas are aligned with the pre-formation betas, we should expect that these portfolios are hedges and they should carry a negative premium. What we find in the data is that they don't. What we have is that the premium is roughly zero on the long short portfolio, despite having a large negative post-formation exposure. Let me go over the main results we have. For the macro hedge portfolios, we're essentially going to do this exercise for all these different series, the industrial production, initial claims, credit spreads, and so on. And the first thing I want to show is to highlight that the market is actually exposed to those things. Because if the market itself is not exposed to macroeconomic conditions, there is no point of building the hedge portfolio to start with. And then I'm going to show that the hedge portfolio actually has a negative exposure to the things we're trying to hedge. Okay, and then later on, I'm going to combine these two, and this is going to be our market macro hedged portfolios. So starting with just the market portfolio, if you take the market portfolio, regress on 1 month changes in industrial production. So I'm standardizing the 1 month changes in industrial production so we can interpret the coefficient as a change in one standard deviation, and the returns on the left side are annualized. So when you have a regressed one change market returns on one change in industrial production, you have a positive coefficient, which means that it is exposed to industrial production. Even if you look at different horizons, for example, 1, 3, or 6 month change in industrial production. Also, if you look at initial claims, we also have exactly the same pattern, which is that it is exposed to these macroeconomic condition captured by changes in initial claims to unemployment. Now, similar, the same thing happened to credit spreads. And surprisingly, it's not very exposed. The point estimate is positive, but it's not statistically different from zero, the relation with the slope of the yield curve. Now, this is showing that the market portfolio is exposed or associated with the real economy, which is something that for some people may be a little surprising, but this is just what the data is telling us. Now, for each one of those eight series, we're going to construct our beta sorted portfolios and construct our hedge. So if we do, we take the first one, if we take the 1 month changes in industrial production and hedge against that variable, what we have is that our hedge portfolio, the portfolio that long the lowest beta bin and short the highest beta bin, does have a negative exposure to 1 month changes in industrial production. This is what we have here with the 95% confidence interval. If we do for the other ones, we have actually very similar, let me go to the end, have very similar pattern in the sense that our hedge portfolio does have, does hedge against these macroeconomic indicators. I wanna highlight that these here are exposed, these are post-formation betas, which is very important as opposed to pre-formation betas.
Bernard, and for people who aren't paying attention to the chat, you should mention that you've normalized the factors by their sign.
Oh, but yes. Yeah, I normalized by the sign. And the only reason is just so that the factors go up in good times and down in bad times. It's just so that it's easier to see here. So, yes, so initial claims and credit spreads, we flip the sign. That's what is here. And we flip the signs because the initial claim goes up in bad times. And now we just don't want to be able to interpret that. Another thing we do here is we standardize the F variable, each one of these factors, to have mean zero and variance one, so that we can interpret the coefficient as a one standard deviation change, the effect of that on the market portfolio at annual percentage terms. Okay. Now, we know that one issue with this analysis so far is that there are like eight series there. We have three versions of initial claims, three versions of industrial production. We have slope of the term structure. We have credit spread. So it's a little bit overwhelming to some extent. What are we gonna do to have a way to convey our main idea in a very simple portfolio is to build a macro hedge portfolio, one that basically is going to hedge against like a combination of them. And how we're gonna do this, we're gonna, for each moment that we're forming the portfolio, instead of hedging against each one individually, within the formation window, so we make sure it's a tradable portfolio, we're going to standardize each one of these variables just because they have different magnitudes. And then we're going to construct an equally weighted average. So it's very similar to like a first principle component of these within each formation window. And then we're going to construct these macro-sensitive portfolios based on the exposure to this combined macro factor. And I want to show that the combined macro factor in the market, they're going to have a very similar pattern to what I showed you before. The nice thing of doing this is that now our hedge portfolio is expected to hedge broad macroeconomic indicators. So I'm going to follow the same structure as before. I'm going to start with the market portfolio and show that the market is exposed to a bunch of macroeconomic indicators of broad macroeconomic conditions. The first one, and I think the most natural one, is to think about recession bars. So these are NBR recessions. So if you take the market portfolio regress on NBR recession dummies, and then what you have here, we flip the sign of the recession. So this positive numbers actually means that it goes down in recessions. So it is exposed to associate. So there's like negative returns in recessions. Similar with, for example, 1 year consumption growth, or if you regress on GDP or other variables like dividend growth, these are broad indicators, or profit growth. These are aggregate variables, and also the 1 year Parker Jr. consumption growth. Now, this is showing that
Bernard, I think you got to explain the y-axis here. So you're not saying that if there's an NBER recession, that the stock market's falling 30%, right?
So that's a good point. So what's going on here is you regress the annualized return on the NBR recession dummy. So the coefficient that we find is that if you annualize the coefficient, you get to 30%. So the estimates are at the monthly level. So you need to take the 30% divided by 12 so that you can get the monthly decline in return associated with NBR recession. Okay. And the other-
There's nothing here that says, it declined, I don't know, whatever 30 divided by 12 is, this month, and it's going to do the same thing for the next 11 months, right? I mean, you're just yeah. multiplying the effects by 12 just to give us a way to think about it.
Exactly. Yeah, it's just to give, exactly. Actually, if you multiply by the average length of a recession in the data, what you have is that number that was in the first slide, which is that on average, it declines 20% per recession. So take the coefficient, instead of multiply by 12 to get the annual value, multiply by the actual number of the length of a recession. That's important to comment. And the other coefficients, we are again standardizing them. So this is one standard deviation change in consumption growth is associated with here about like 8% at annual terms in returns. Now the macro hedge portfolio, the one that is hedging against this combined version of macro risk, what we have is again negative exposures in all these categories. So what we have, let me go to the end because I thought it would be easier to see on Zoom, but keeps like changing too much. What we have is that the hedge portfolio have negative exposure to recession, to consumption, to GDP, dividend, profits, and also alternative measures of consumption growth. So this is important again, because we're not even sorting on GDP growth exposure. We're not sorting on exposure to profit growth. We're sorting on these combined macro factors. And then what we're saying is that our macro hedge portfolio actually hedges against a wide variety of macroeconomic indicators, from consumption to profits to dividends and GDP and so on. So this is an interesting and useful feature that the hedge portfolio is working precisely the way we wanted it to work. Now, going back to this surprising result we have, which is that, okay, you can build these hedge portfolios, these long short portfolios, but you know, what is the cost associated with doing that? What is the reduction or increase in expected returns that you would face if you hold this portfolio? What we have is that this is the average return on the market portfolio with the 95% confidence interval. This is from like Ken French website. Now, the average return on the hedge portfolio, this long short portfolio, is a zero. It's very, very close to zero. It's slightly positive, but honestly, it's like you can't really distinguish between that and zero. And what is interesting is that the 95% confidence interval, it's kind of similar even to the market confidence interval, which means that it's not that we have like a very noisy thing. It's just as noisy as probably the market portfolio. What is interesting is that if you combine these two, if you do the market plus the hedge, what you have is that the average return is similar to the market portfolio and the confidence interval is also similar. So we have a portfolio that is very similar like the market to the market portfolio in terms of average returns and volatility. However, it does hedge against a wide variety of macroeconomic indicators. So this is an interesting result we have, that the cost associated with building this portfolio in terms of reduction in expected return seems to be very small, even slightly negative because the point estimate here is negative. Now, what I want to show is that I know that recessions are not are specific events and they're not very frequent. So for example, there is one now, there was one in 2008, there's one in 2001, there's one in like 91, and then in the early 80s, and then they were like more frequently back then. So what I'm going to do is I want to go over each one of those recessions and look at how our market plus hedge portfolio performed. So I know this is more like anecdotal, but it's overwhelming the effect that the hedge portfolio has in terms of hedging against these particularly bad times. So for example, this is the COVID-19 pandemic. So if you were to invest $1 in January 2020, this would be the performance of your portfolio up until the first half of the year. If you invest in the market plus our hedge portfolio, you pretty much would be able to avoid a lot of the drawdown faced by the investor that invested only on the market portfolio. So it performed really well. And I want to emphasize that this is an out of sample results because our original sample ended before the pandemic happened and we thought we had to see if our hedge portfolio performed. It's very important because it's an out of sample test. It becomes more I think it becomes makes our results much more robust to that extent. We can also look at previous recessions, and that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go over a lot of the recessions. So I'm going to go a little faster on those like recessions. But if you look into the 2008 recession, this is the performance of the market. And if you were to hedge against, use our market plus hedge portfolio, you see that it dropped, but it dropped much later. It dropped exactly when the market was recovering. So in that sense, our hedge actually is working against market movements, and the drawdown is significantly lower. That recession had a drawdown of more than 50%, and our drawdown is maybe like close to 40%, but it happened much later. That's an important aspect of what we do. If you go back to 2001, very similar results we have. It does hedge against a lot of the market movements and avoided the decline in stock markets. If you go back to 1991 recession, of course, it's not going to work in every single one of them, but I find it remarkable how well it worked in the COVID-19 pandemic in 2001 and 2008. For 1991, it didn't fully hedge the beginning, but it does recover faster than the market portfolio. For the 1980s, we also have a very similar result in terms of avoiding the market crash. Now, I want to highlight one thing, which is that there is also another important event, and maybe it's a little bit too anecdotal, but I think it's an important market crash that happened in the history of stock market, which is the crash of 1987. In 1987, there's like a large market crash. We probably all know about this. At least I read about it. I was extremely young at the time, couldn't even speak. And the market crash here, it was not associated with macroeconomic conditions. My understanding is that it was associated with like liquidity issues and so on. And our hedge portfolios were never intended to hedge against these type of movements. And it didn't. Basically, it crashed at the same time as the market crashed, because it's not intended to do that. It's not intended to correct liquidity issues. It's more related to macroeconomic conditions. So I think this is also another important result that we have. Okay, so Valentin, how much time do I have? I think I lost track.
All right, okay. That'll be me, actually. You have
Lars, yeah.
Yeah, you have about 15 minutes or so. Actually,
a little bit longer. Okay, thank you. Okay, so let's take a step back. And now what I'm going to talk about is going to be much closer to the points that Greg pointed out. It was like a very good, very nice description. And I think it's important to be very clear on that, what our results have to say on these like estimations of prices of risks, heterogeneity in beta, and so on. Our macro hedge portfolios, we can use them as test assets, just like when you run a Fama-Macbeth procedure to estimate the price of risk, or for example, the Parker Jr. consumption growth, or Yaganathan and Wong Q4 to Q4 consumption growth, or teams on future consumption growth. And typically the literature has tested the pricing of risk against the 25 Fama French portfolios. So these are 25 portfolios double sorted on size and book to market. But notice that our 10 portfolios, if you take our macro sensitive portfolios, these are precisely the type of portfolio that perform well in good times, is going to be more or less sensitive to macroeconomic conditions. So if we're talking about consumption-based asset pricing models, or if we're talking about portfolios, factors that capture macroeconomic conditions, we view our test assets as like kind of a natural candidate to look at. And we find some like interesting results here, and that I really want to share with you. So using a more updated sample, I just want to show you the basic result that you already have in the literature, which is that if you estimate the price of risk. So this is the premium of each one of the 25 Fama French portfolios. And this is the price of risk associated with the factor in question. So we have PJ Parker Jr. consumption factor, Q4 to Q4 consumption growth, and unfiltered consumption growth. And you see that they're all like positive and roughly like statistically significant. It's a little bit different from the original result because we're using a sample that it's slightly longer a sample that I took, we took from Tim's website actually. And if instead of using the 25 Fama French portfolios, which is, has been like the main focus of the asset pricing literature, like we have to explain those 25 portfolios, we're gonna look at our 10 sorted portfolios in the sense that our 10 portfolios are exactly the portfolios we expect them to have, like a high exposure when it's more macro sensitive, a low exposure when it's less sensitive. But at the same time, we're finding that the long short hedges against macro conditions without lowering returns. What we find when we use our 10 hedge portfolios is a much lower estimate for lambda one for the price of risk. This is only using 10. So there's only like 10 test assets in the cross section. And this has like 25 assets in the cross section. If you use, for example, 35 combining the two, then those point estimates are gonna be like a little higher here, somewhere around here, but not statistically significant. So this is an interesting result that we have. And I wanna highlight a few points from that. First one is that in terms of revisiting, it's not about like revisiting the whole literature on prices of risk of macro factors, but the literature is arguing that macro risk explains a lot of the variation in cross-section returns. The typical approach has been to focus on the 25 portfolios double sorted on size and book to market by FAMA in French to estimate the price of risk of these macro risk. Of course, there are like several critiques to the traditional approach. I don't want to get into the details of that. Greg highlighted one important of them, which is this: if you have a weak spread in betas, then the FAMA-Macbeth regressions, you may run into issues because you don't have enough variation on the right-hand side when you're doing the second stage of the FAMA-Macbeth procedure. Our portfolios, the way we view them is that there are different test assets to evaluate these models, and they have spreads in beta that are directly related to macro risk. And when you use them, you have very different price of risk estimates, typically lower, a lot closer to zero, which is consistent with our previous result that we are able to hedge macroeconomic risk without lowering average returns. And remember that those are like well-diversified portfolios, tradable and well-diversified portfolios. Okay, so the last thing I wanna highlight today, and I hope not everyone is like bored for me talking for so long, but an interesting aspect is that if you think about our results of being able to hedge against macroeconomic risk or macroeconomic recessions, is that there is something to do with the volatility of the stochastic discount factor. So far what we have is like, it looks like a little bit inconsistent with existing factors, as single factors to explain the cross-sectional returns. And it could be, we don't know, that our hedge portfolios are loading on something else that we do not observe. Could be that our beta sorted portfolios are loading on something and maybe it doesn't affect much the SDF. Because if we're saying that it's cheap to hedge against macro risk, maybe macro risk is not a very important component of the stochastic discount factor. And we're gonna have something to say about those omitted factors in the sense of we're gonna be able to answer the question of what is the contribution of macro risk to the stochastic discount factor volatility. What we're gonna do is a very intuitive approach, which is pretty much like heavily based on imposing a bound on the volatility of the SDF coming from macro risk. And it's a simple application of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to the Euler equation. Intuitively, what we have is, imagine that you pick a factor model. So let's say the FAMA and French three-factor model, then that model is going to have a maximum, a sharp ratio bound, which is you can take the full sample, like mean variance efficient portfolio, that is the highest sharp ratio portfolio. What we're gonna do is take that portfolio, the highest sharp ratio, it's not a tradable, but we are not like focused on tradability here, it's more about understanding the stochastic discount factor volatility component coming from macro risks. We're gonna use that mean variance efficient portfolio. And then on that portfolio, we're gonna add our macro hedge and hedge out against movements in recessions. And we're gonna do this in a way that the exposure to NBR recession becomes zero. So we're gonna choose exactly the right amount of hedging such that the exposure to macroeconomic risk here, like NBR recession, is eliminated. Now, efficient portfolio plus the hedge is going to have a different Sharpe ratio. And what we have is the difference between the maximum possible Sharpe ratio and the Sharpe ratio of this reduced, macro hedged efficient portfolio is going to tell us about the contribution of macroeconomics to the stochastic discount factor. Why? Think about that. Imagine that the Sharpe ratios are very similar. What it's saying is that, you know what, you add the macro hedge to the mean variance efficient portfolio, the Sharpe ratio pretty much doesn't change much. So you're still very close to the efficient frontier. Nothing really like changed in a significant way. So that means that the contribution of macro to the stochastic discount rate volatility is gonna be very small. Now, if your Sharpe ratio declines too much, then it means that there's like a component of the SDF that matters. And we can quantify those bounds. And we're gonna do in a very simple way. Imagine that you have an stochastic discount factor, which we normalize to have a mean one, given by one minus BZ. So Z here is the macro risk. And then there's also these other factors where those could be unobserved as well. Our hedge portfolio, by definition, is going to be the minus Z. So it's like hedging against movements in Z. And of course, there's like some residual that it could contain potentially like exposure to this unobserved factor as well. Our market macro hedge portfolio is going to be such that when you add our hedge portfolio by a factor beta, it fully eliminates Z. So we're going to fully eliminate the effect of Z on the market macro hedge portfolio. So it's going to be a market with zero market exposure. Now, when I mentioned that it's a simple application of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequalities, that starting from the Euler equation, we're going to be able to pin down Sharpe ratio bounds. So this is the Euler equation because it's in excess returns. So we know that this is a Sharpe ratio. It's bounded by the volatility here of the unobserved factor. After like working out this math, you can simplify that in a way that the fraction of volatility in the stochastic discount factor coming from the macro. So this is the term that you have the volatility on the macro divided by the total volatility of the stochastic discount factor. It's more or less, it's less or equal than one minus the Sharpe ratio fraction squared. So you see that when the mean variance efficient macro hedge and the mean variance efficient portfolio have similar Sharpe ratios, this is going to be kind of close to one, and the whole thing is going to be close to zero. Now, if the Sharpe ratio here goes to zero, this is going to be close to one. So we have a very nice decomposition of the fraction of the volatility coming from macro-based risks. And we can do this empirically. We can actually go for different models, different factor models, compute the mean variance efficient Sharpe ratio, and then also compute hedge against macro risk, compute that Sharpe ratio, and then look at those bounds. Now, one thing we'd also do to have a very conservative estimate is that when we look at the mean variance efficient Sharpe ratio, you could compute that within the factor model, or you could compute within the factor model, including the hedge portfolio, just to make sure this ratio is always less than one. So that's what we do to be even more conservative. Anything, this goes even higher, which increases the macro component. And our finding is that that component is not very large, especially when you go to more sophisticated models. So you see that this is the Sharpe ratio of the original factor model. This is the recession hedged. So the original one plus recession hedged, the Sharpe ratio of those portfolios. You see that, of course, they keep like going up just because the models become more sophisticated. You're adding more factors, and then you're able to get like a higher Sharpe ratio. The interesting results here is that the variance, the upper bound on the variance share It's roughly about like 60% for like very standard models like the CAPM and the Fama French three-factor model. As you go to more sophisticated models that you include momentum, you include profitability, you include investments and so on, that becomes substantially lower, that in ranges between like a 13 to 32%. So to conclude, I think I'm on time. What we have is portfolios are based on exposure. We view them as natural test assets in the sense that they're going to be associated with macroeconomic conditions. They're going to be sensitive precisely to moments in time that are bad in terms of economic conditions. What we have is an evidence of the relation between exposure to these macro indicators and expected return. That relation is flat, especially in recessions, which is a very interesting result that you think that those are particularly bad times, and we find this pattern. It also holds, and I haven't hold not only for these macro factors that I showed today, but also for reduced form factors. If you do the same analysis using daily data, so here we have like a higher frequency, so you can go like to daily data, the same results hold if you look at the market, at the all the Fama French five factors, momentum, and so on. So this is kind of an interesting finding as well. Those are like at the end of those slides if you're interested, and also very much detailed in the paper. In terms of implications of what we have is we're able to build these hedges against macro risk, and they're good hedges against recession-led financial crises. So these are stock market crashes associated with recession, and provide new test assets to evaluate models. And we find these prices of risk lower, typically like closer to zero. And an interesting finding, which is the last thing I mentioned, is that it makes us help us think about what is the contribution of economic fluctuations and recessions to the volatility or to overall these stochastic discount factors. In terms of tradability for the reduced form factors, because they're tradable, the analysis become a little bit different. We can actually talk about alphas relative to the original factors, which is also an interesting set of results. I think that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Let's give it back to Greg, so if you can unshare your slides.
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah.
Done.
Lars, are we okay?
Yes, we are okay.
All right. So one reason I like this paper is because it challenges asset pricers to think differently. So what do I mean by that? Here's the old literature. We want to be able to explain cross-sectional variation in mean returns to assets, and we want to be able to do it with exposure to macro shocks, and we can't do it, and so that sucks, we failed. This paper says, no, that's a success. Success here is not in, let me think of it this way. Success here is really saying we can build portfolios that are not exposed to big macro risks, and yet you still have a high expected return. Now, maybe that's bad for economic theory, but it's gonna be good for your pocketbook, right? So that's, it's forcing us to, it's trying to make us think differently about these results. Now, that revised interpretation is only gonna work if macro risks are big deals in the sense that they account for a substantial amount of risk that you face in the stock market. And my one criticism is that I'm not sure that's true here. So let's look at one particular example from their paper. So one of their macro risks is the change in a 6-month change in industrial production. So they gave me their data and I was playing around with it. And what I'm doing in this slide is I'm using their quintiles of exposure to the 6-month change in industrial production. And I'm calculating their betas, and I'm putting the sample mean excess returns on the vertical axis. The black circles are their quintiles. There's a little red circle there that's the market. You draw the blue line, but through them, that's the OLS second pass regression. And the OLS second pass regression says, this is just not a price risk. It's just not something that matters much to people. Well, what I also do is I show how well their hedged portfolio gets to a zero exposure to the factor. So the hedged portfolio here, you just start with the market and then you add in the low beta portfolio. So you subtract the high beta portfolio, that gives you the X. The X happens to lie in the blue line. There's no particular reason that is true. On the next slide, it turns out it doesn't. But anyway, so there's not much compensation for this risk. But if I had started this discussion with the table at the bottom, the R squares, you would say, well, that's not a surprise at all, because exposure to 6-month industrial changes in industrial production just don't matter at all for these portfolios. I mean, you've got the biggest R square you have here is 2.7%. It would be kind of weird if exposures along with this kind of magnitude, these R squares, actually mattered much. All right, so that's 6-month IP. The paper presentation focused a lot more on the combined macro risk, where you combine industrial production and initial jobless claims and other stuff, the credit spreads, other things I don't remember. Anyway, you just combine it all, right? So that's the next slide. So I'm just plotting the same kind of figure here. The black circles are the combination of the betas of their portfolios and the sample mean returns for their exposures to these combined macro risks. The red circle is the market. You draw a line through those things with your second pass regression and you get a price of risk that's zero. I mean, slightly negative. Here, that construction of the hedged portfolio doesn't quite work so great. It overshot, but let's not worry about that. Again, but what matters here is go down to that table. And this is the combined macro risk. They're combining all of these things and saying, what's the, you know, if this is how we're going to measure macro risks, how exposed are you to it? And you get an R square of 1.3% for the stock market as a whole. Again, you can call these macro risks, but they're just really tiny, right? So now one thing the paper does, and I think this is important, is it says, well, look, we don't really care so much about these particular macro risks. These particular macro risks are really a means to an end. They want to be able to use exposure to these, to be able to use the portfolios that they construct this way, and then talk about bigger macroeconomic risks like NBER recessions or aggregate consumption. So that's the one last thing I'm going to look at in my discussion here. So I'm going to remind you of the slide I had at the beginning. This is the picture I had at the beginning, where we're looking to test whether exposure to annual consumption growth, measured the way Jagannathan and Wang measure it, can explain cross-sectional variation in mean returns to these portfolios, right? So the previous literature says, gee, they seem to line up really nicely, but there may actually be nothing here, right? So what do you get with their approach? So what they're gonna do is they're gonna form, I'm gonna go to the next slide to show what they're gonna do. They're gonna form decile portfolios on exposure to their monthly macro risk. And then they're gonna use these portfolios, which they've defined relative to macro, this monthly macro risk, construct annual returns, and then use the annual returns to these portfolios to estimate these aggregate consumption betas, the consumption betas, the exposure to annual consumption growth, right? So on the horizontal axis, we have these annual consumption betas, just like we did on the previous slide, we have annual consumption betas. And on the vertical axis, we have these sample mean returns to these portfolios. And this picture is showing Bernard's point, which is that if you use these portfolios to test this standard asset pricing paradigm, G is exposure to aggregate consumption risk priced, you get absolutely nothing. I mean, the sign is wrong, okay? So they're saying, look, if we expand beyond the FOM and French portfolios, we're gonna get very different results. Okay, but let's go back to the objection that Kleibergen and Zhang had with the Farmer French portfolios. They're not estimated precisely enough. So let's ask the question about that here. So what's on this slide? It's the same slide I had before, except what I've done with these red, the red lines, is I've constructed plus and minus two standard error bounds on two of the estimated betas, the lowest estimated beta and the highest estimated beta. So the red bars, plus or minus two standard error bounds of these things. And these are big, right? That there's so much, even though you form portfolios the best way you could using these monthly data, once you start taking them and asking, what are your betas with when you have, look at annual returns and annual macroeconomic risks, the standard errors, once again, just blow up. You can't reject the hypothesis at the 10% level that every single one of these betas, the true betas, is exactly the same. And that puts us right back to Kleibergen and Zhang, which says, you know, even though these betas are, you know, you've done a great job trying to construct them, there's still nothing here, and we still can't identify a risk premium. So that's the discouraging slide. Okay, so what do I think the paper needs to do? I think it needs, one thing it needs to do is, I mean, they spend a lot of time talking about the properties of this hedged portfolio. I think what they want to do is spend a little time at least telling researchers why we care about their hedged portfolio, the way they construct it, relative to like the zillion other ways we can construct hedged portfolios, right? So their big advantage is it's a really simple thing to do. Does that simplicity also mean it's robust? If so, that says this is a good technology, but I think they want to do a little investigating of that. And then in line with the introduction I gave to the paper, yes, they're after better betas. I think they need even better ones. And here, I think they want to take more seriously the idea that goes back to Master and Stambaugh, that we want to focus on predicting future betas. And to do that, let's be serious about that and build factor models, because we're dealing with a very limited amount of data here. And the more accuracy we can produce with these betas, the better. That's it for me.
All right. Thank you very much, Greg. So I'm going to give Ebrard a chance to respond. But before that, I just want to remind everybody that if you want to ask a question now in the upcoming Q&A session, that you use the raise hand feature so we can call on you. But Bernard and Crude, do you guys want to respond to Greg a little bit?
Yes. Can you hear me? Great. Okay. So Greg, thank you so much for the feedback, especially I like the way you explained in terms of like building even better data. I think that's something there are a lot of things you said we have to think more carefully about. So thank you very much for the very thoughtful really enjoyed the discussion. I do have a few comments that I would like to address, especially on the beta heterogeneity point, which is that the papers you mentioned, this literature is very new. The Kleibergen and Zhang paper is like a Journal of Finance 2020. There's a recent working paper by team from this year, 2020. This is like a super interesting area of research, very insightful to read, especially like this idea that if betas are like too close, you may have not be like identified. So really have to think carefully from the econometrics perspective, what we're actually doing. So I highly recommend everyone attending here to read those papers. They're very, very like nicely written papers. A key point that relate to what we do, just to like repeat a little bit of what he said to make sure everyone here understands, is that the point is that we need dispersion in betas in the cross section. So this is important because the Fama-Macbeth procedure, it uses the betas heterogeneity in the cross section in order to identify the prices of risks in the second stage. So to get the lambda one right, you need heterogeneity in betas in the cross section. So if you don't have variation in beta, it becomes very hard to estimate prices of risks correctly. So that said, it is less clear how to address this issue. So for example, the Kleinberg and Zhang paper is a very insightful paper, and they propose a test under like some assumptions. Some of them are normality of IID returns. They look at the asymptotic distribution. The issue with that is there's also evidence in the literature that this test might actually be overly harsh. It may end up rejecting, maybe like more often than we wanted to, and it's gonna end up rejecting things that they shouldn't be rejected. So for example, that's like an important point in Tim's paper, which is to show in his recent working paper that the Kleinberg and Jung test fails to reject, for example, that mean returns are jointly zero. So this is a problem because if there is no equity premium to start with and no variation in average returns, that may be problematic from an asset pricing perspective. So I'm not here like to pick sides saying like, oh, the Kleinberg and Jung is like wrong or right, or the Tim's paper is wrong or right. It's not like my goal is not to divide into the specifics of econometrics. Our paper is not like an econometric paper, but I view these inconsistencies as important to take into account when you're running these tests. These are like relatively large inconsistencies. It's kind of hard to ignore. The more important thing that I want to say and I want to highlight to this literature, I know because we are aware of these papers for a while and we've been spending a lot of time thinking about it, is that even if we do have a reliable test, it's not clear from our perspective that this is the right test that we have to, that we need. Let me explain a little bit our reasoning on that. So the first of all is that how we form our portfolios and the monotonicity observed in our post-formation portfolios are ignoring this type of test. So the portfolios are constructed based on pre-formation betas, and the test ignores whether pre-formation betas align, for example, with post-formation betas. For example, ignores if portfolios in the highest beta bucket, if they have indeed a post-formation beta higher than the portfolios in the lowest beta bucket. In our paper, we're interested in dispersion in betas in a specific way because our portfolios are intended to hedge macroeconomic risk. And post-formation beta becomes very important in that sense. And we're interested in have a reliable hedge portfolio with negative exposure to macro risk, exposure that is statistically significant, but also economically large, because otherwise the hedge itself is not, it doesn't work. It's not work as intended to do. And in that sense, I think we do have a robust set of results and valid hedge portfolios in the sense that we're able to hedge these macroeconomic conditions. And our portfolios have variation in exposure to macro risk, measured by like various way, like that plot that I have with all the bars. That's exactly what it was showing. Maybe like a simpler way to do, to focus on these tests without going to the econometrics details, is to simply look at, instead of using all the 10 portfolios, just look at the extreme ones, the long, the high, min, the low minus high bucket, and look at the exposure of that one relative to these factors. So going back to the estimation of the prices of risk, just to quickly conclude, I may take too long to answer this, but we're saying that when you use our macro sensitive portfolios, the way I view the results that we have in terms of the estimations of beta, you know, taking with a grain of salt this whole heterogeneity beta aspect of the estimate, is that the estimates that we have using traditional, traditional econometric tools, is that they're lower and they're sometimes are like closer to zero. And our point is that these macro sensitive portfolios are precisely the test assets that have variation in exposure to macroeconomic risk. And we find this important because it's not our main like point in the paper, but it kind of confirms our finding that a significant part of macroeconomic risk is hedgeable. And that's like a key takeaway that we have without lowering average returns. So that said, I think your comment on taking like a closer look and how we construct the betas and like different ways of looking at it are extremely, extremely helpful. So I really, really appreciate your comments. I know this probably doesn't answer all the things you mentioned, maybe I'm forgetting something, but we'll definitely look more carefully at your discussion slides. So thank you again for all the comments.
Okay, thank you, Bernard. We'll go to a couple of comments and questions. The first one is Claudia Moyes. Yes, Claudia.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so my question was whether the authors have looked at the correlation between the hedging portfolio and innovation index on innovation fundamental volatility. So the idea is that during recession and financial crisis, VIX and the market return have opposite patterns. So what I have in mind is projecting VIX, and I'm talking about, of course, innovation index, VIX or fundamental volatility on the space of returns obtaining a long short portfolio that way and comparing this hedging portfolio, meaning market plus this long short, with the hedging portfolio that they have in the paper. So in other words, why should I go through the exercise of building the hedging portfolio the way they do when I can go straight to the VIX? What are the benefits? Do they obtain a larger Sharpe ratio, lower risk, things like that?
Okay, can I answer that?
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, thank you, Claudia. This is actually a very interesting comment, I think. We haven't done that comparison specifically, but we know that's actually an important result in Eng's Journal of Finance paper from 2006, which is that Eng and co-authors, they build these like VIX beta sorted portfolios. And one important finding that they have is that long short portfolio has a negative premium. That's like a one important finding that a lot of people, when they read that paper, they focus on the volatility puzzle that, oh, it sucks with like high volatility, they don't have higher returns. But there's like a whole section in that paper focused exactly on building these VIX sorted portfolios. We haven't compared exactly, but one difference that for sure is that there's a differences in premium, but that's something we should maybe think more carefully. More carefully about. I don't know if my co-authors want to add anything. Maybe I'm forgetting something. Alan and Tyler.
I think that's, you're right on the money. I think the key difference is the premium. I mean, portfolio sorted on VIX are shown to have, you know, a high premium. I mean, you can still hedge. It's pretty good, but you're going to pay for it. And of course, VIX doesn't have only macro. Has it's plain variation on the market much more broadly. While ours is targeted on macro risks in particular, but that would be the key difference. Yeah.
Okay, let's grab one more question here. So, slash comment from Jules van Binsbergen at Wharton. Hey, Jules, go ahead.
You hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. All I wanted to say was that Craig Burnside made a very big deal out of all this beta uncertainty and the fact that the betas are not statistically different from each other, and he first applied this to the but then also did quite a bit of work in the cross-section of stock returns. It's a pity you didn't follow through, but I posted an SRN link where essentially all these points are already made to the 10. He posted it 10 years ago. He started making this point 12 years ago.
All right. Thank you, Jules. Any comments, guys?
I guess he's relating to the Kleinberg-Zhang paper. I think that's... is that your point, Jules? I agree. We are trying. I mean, the way that we put it, that, you know, the literature before the attack was like, look, there is absence of evidence because we can't estimate this bet as well. And what we're trying to do in this paper is like try to, you know, actually construct portfolios that are sensitive to macro risks, so we can like move the literature from absence of evidence for evidence of absence, which is more powerful. And I think that's what we're trying to do. I think the climbers end, they have kind of a formalization, a test that under some conditions might make sense. I think you have to be careful how you use it. And if you use it thoughtfully, I think can be good machinery. That's all I have to say. Yeah. Thank you, George. That's very useful. But I didn't know that paper, so we should... We should look at it.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. I think we're out of time. So I'm just going to say thank you for showing up today. Thank you to Greg and thank you to Bernard. Next week, we got Eric Zwick. He's going to present Top Wealth in America, New Estimates, Implication for Taxing the Rich, with an introduction and discussion by Emmanuel Saez. So please tune in for next week. And until then, have a great weekend and see you then. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Really, right. Feedback.